when I first started out, I forgot my couch and I turned up for her treatment and just went, oh, I've forgotten my couch. Hello and welcome to another episode of the Massage and Physical Therapist Roundtable Talk Show. In the last episode, we were discussing how to avoid burnout. So I'm sure most of you can relate to the topic. If you want to go check it out, it is in the playlist below, episode 10. So in each episode, we pick a topic as chosen by you and discuss it from different perspectives within the therapy world. Your host, Kate Brown. And on the panel today, we have Chris Haddon, massage therapist and reflexologist.
Hey, oh, you're right.
Imogen Tester, massage therapist. Tamer Morsi, massage therapist. And Claire King, massage therapist and craniosacral therapist. So welcome all this morning. Thank you to those of us, those of you who are joining us. How's everyone doing? Everyone good today? It's a bit grey and wet, isn't it? But inspiring.
Yeah, not bad.
I was going to say
bad.
February, but it's March, isn't it?
Yes, it is March. Had a very exciting pancake day yesterday. I'm always excited about that.
Oh, me too.
Oh, you missed it.
Oh.
I do this every year.
Oh, I love it. Love it.
Oh, that's sad. All right. Well, today we are asking what are the pros and cons of mobile massage? So we've got a bit of a mixed group. Some of us have done mobile, some of us do it regularly, and others haven't really done much of it at all. But regardless, we'll be sort of weighing up the pros and cons of each setup, but we'll sort of be focusing on the mobile setup. So, yeah, looking forward to getting tucked into this one today. For those of you that don't know, I run a mobile massage business, so I've probably got quite a lot of stories I can share on this one today, but we'll go around. And I think, Chris, would you like to start for us today? Because I know you do quite a bit of mobile as well.
Yeah, I mean, you could actually, I mean, with my setup, you could technically say that I'm mobile just because I work from a boat and the boat moves. But
That is true. but I know you do some of the corporate stuff as well, which is kind of, yeah, quite different to doing the sort of home mobile treatments, but we can go into that a bit. You kind of work in both scenarios, don't you? You work sort of almost from home, which is your boat, and then a bit on the road. So what would you say you prefer out of the two? What's your sort of feelings about both environments?
I mean, I definitely prefer just working from my premises, if you like, you know, because you've not got the to in and fro in, the lugging, everything's set, everything's nice, you've got it how you want it. However, I do some home visits, but I only do them now on a sort of ask me basis, if you like. There's no way of booking an online, booking a home visit through my website. I trialed that 8 years ago and it was just pandemonium because everyone had someone that I just couldn't get it fine-tuned enough that someone were booking at one side of Manchester and then someone were booking on the other side of Manchester, you know, and it was just too stressful. I just can't be doing with that, you know. But I do have clients that can't get to me, you know. I've got some elderly clients. I've got some clients where it's not suitable for them to be clambering onto a canal boat, you know, and in them instances, I have no problems at all going to them. And I quite like them home visits because it's different, it changes things up a bit. And that is one positive for me, is that you're in a different environment. So you're not just in the same room, same space all the time. But you are lugging your stuff there. If it's raining, you're thinking, oh God, and you're lugging all your... And then you get to the house, if it's somewhere you've not been before, and it's like a high-rise block of flats and you're on the very top floor, for instance, the lifts aren't working. You know, there's all these kinds of things. You get there and they say, oh yeah, I've got a nice room in here, and you go in and the room is like absolutely tiny, you know, you've got no space to move. All these things, that's just part of it. But the joy of the home stuff is that it does take off the pressure in a little bit, and it's not down to you of how nice the room is and the heating and all that. Obviously, it's not your space, so you can only advise and say, you know, please make sure your room's nice and warm and et cetera, et cetera. But it's not your it's one less thing for you to have to get right. It's completely down to them. You're just turning up to do the service. So again, it can then feel a little bit like you're not giving them the full package, if you like, the full thing. Whereas when they come to you, you've got your own sort of smells on you in your diffuser. You've got the heating just right. You know, everything's where it needs to be. So I mean, I'm pro work from my own place. You know, if I had to choose, if I had to stop one, it would definitely be the mobile treatments, but I don't mind doing them on an as and when basis.
Yeah, because you're in control of your environment then, aren't you? As you sort of said, you have everything set up and you know, you can have it how you like it, but really quite often you don't know what you're going into when you're going into a mobile setting. And there are sort of ways to get around that, sort of having advice for clients and letting them know what spaces are suitable or not. I imagine working in a city environment for mobile is very, very different to working in a rural setting. So I'm out in the country and I don't think there's a single high rise around me, actually. So, you know, there are different problems you encounter of different areas than me. I might get stuck on a farm road, which is really unsuitable for vehicles. And for you might have to get yourself up a 100-story building or something to go and see someone.
It's parking as well. I mean, I'm sure everyone can relate to this, but parking just really stresses me out. It's not a lot of things that stress me out, but it's parking. It's like last night, you talk about pancakes. We went out to go, I'm just going off topic here, but we went out for pancakes and what a lovely experience that's meant to be, and I just couldn't find anywhere to park. You know what I mean? And it's like you go to do these mobile treatments, and you'd think if there was nowhere to park on the road or it was tricky or whatever, you'd just think that they'd have let you know that in advance so that you can allow extra time. But no, nothing's been mentioned, and you turn up and there's like nowhere to park, and you're like, and then you end up losing half the time. I mean, I'm pretty sure there's one where I've had to cancel it because I've like spent half the time trying to find somewhere to park, you know. But you need to drive, really, to take your stuff. I mean, obviously, if you're in city centre London and you've got good transport links and you can hop on the tube, I don't know, then and wheel your stuff along, that'd probably be fine. But where I am, transport's not great in Manchester, really. It can be a lot better, so... you are stuck to just driving, and then you've got them issues as well. So,
yeah, massive respect to any mobile therapists working in London or other city environments, because it must be so much harder. As you said, parking being the primary issue. I couldn't imagine having to lug my massage table on the tube. That must just be, so exhausting. But if you are in less of a city setting, I think the problems around that are much less. And in my sort of mobile experience, most people in the rural setting that I'm in will have their own drive, or they'll have their own parking space. Or if they don't, I make it very clear that we can't actually provide services to them if there isn't suitable parking and access. Because at the end of the day, it's our bodies that we're, you know, putting at risk through having to lug our equipment too far. So that's something I make sure is sort of part of our information upright, so people can realise that can be an issue. Tamar, should we pass over to you? I know you've got less time this morning and might have to go early.
Sure. So basically, my setup, I'm mainly working mobile. I used to hire a room in a spa in the high street next to my place, but for about a year. But to be honest, the amount of clients that I was getting from for home visits were much more. I'm the type of person that I prefer, to be honest, the home visit. I drive when the client is up to 10 minutes away from me. And if I have any clients close to central London, basically in central London area, I just take transportation. It's very easy. There is a trolley. There is a nice trolley for the table, so I don't need to carry the table all the time. It makes it very convenient to move with the trolley. And to be honest, I prefer home visits. There is always a story. there is always a story, no matter how big or small it is. There is this element of fun, of suspense, that there is a surprise that I have no, and especially with new clients, that's just it. For me, it makes my day, to be honest. Sometimes I have regular clients that I see every week, and basically sometimes I go through phases that I want to see a client I never seen before. I want this element of surprise to see what's going to happen. There is just if I would wrap up the pros and cons, the pros is that there is no overhead, you're not paying rent. The cons, of course, the transportation time between clients. However, transportation time, moving time between one client to the other, that can, you can consider it as a waste of time, or you can consider it as a me time, because you get to go to nice places, you get to sit down and have a coffee in between clients. If you have like 2 hours gap, you can just have lunch. So yeah, overall, to be honest, I prefer home visits big time.
Great, thank you. So we've got 1 point to each so far. Claire, would you like to come up? Because I know that you're not really sort of much on the mobile side, Chris.
No, I don't do it anymore. I haven't done it for years. But actually what Tamer said, I used to love that suspense, because I used to go to some pretty nice houses. I live in London, and also it was before the full-on congestion charge. That's how long ago I used to do it. So although sometimes parking was an issue, I didn't have that, you know, expense on top of it. But that has really reminded me of, I'd, you know, get an address and think, oh, that's going to be nice. And then I'd rock up. And then I'd always make sure that I took, you know, my kind of cloth that I would put, or towel, underneath the table, because often there would be like this massive, amazing carpet like this deep, and then I'd be, you know, really worried that I was going to like spill oil on the carpet. So I always remember that. So I liked it for that reason, that suspense, and just, you know, going in and thinking, oh my goodness, this is amazing. And, you know, I can't remember specifics because it was a long time ago, but I had some pretty fun clients that were just so rich, and it was just like another, you know, just another world. So yeah, I enjoyed it, but I generally did that in the evenings. So I did like it for that part, but then I just got fed up of lugging stuff around, to be honest. It was too much. And, you know, I remember often I'd be, you know, carrying the massage couch up, you know, a couple of flights, or, you know, one person's house. It was always in their loft room. And, you know, I just had to kind of get the couch up there and be like, it's fine, I can do it by myself, don't worry. And then the other thing I used to do, which I'd also forgotten about, was I used to do a lot of office massage with the chair, which weighed 10 kilos. And I was really happy just kind of putting it on my back, and I'd walk to the train, get on the train. People thought I was a cellist. I'd just go along with that. Get in there. And I even carried that on my back whilst I was about 5 months pregnant. Happy as Larry, just walking around with 10 kilos. I enjoyed it for that reason. But then I think, you know, I just got to the point where I thought, I can't be bothered to lug that stuff in. It was just extra time. I enjoyed it when I did it, but it's not for me anymore.
No, totally understandable. And yeah, some really good points. I like what you were saying about the putting a towel underneath the table. That's a really good idea.
Yeah.
I have to say, since discovering waxes, those have been a fantastic thing to have as a mobile therapist, because you instantly have, you've just lost that risk of spilling your oil everywhere, or it's leaked all over the sofa or something hideous like that. So waxes, I highly recommend, if you're going to be mobile, get a pot of massage wax rather than...
Yeah, don't use oil.
Just normal oil. Lovely. Imogen, should we pass over to you?
Hi, yeah. So I was just saying, listening to what Claire was saying, I remember, because when I started my own business, I worked mobile for a while, and laminate floors as well. So I had, when I started off, I had this sort of like a mobile table, And I remember a couple of houses that they'd have this lovely shiny laminate floor, and you'd start at one end of the room, you'd slowly be making your way across the other end of the room. So I'd remember to put a mat down to stop you moving across the floor. That reminded me of that. Yeah, it was great.
The table moved across.
Yeah, the table would be slowly sliding across the floor as I was massaging.
You must be very strong. I've never had that happen.
I think
before.
My table's got little plasticky feet on it, so it's quite slippy. So when I started my own business, I did start mobile, and if someone's starting off, it's such a great low risk way of starting your business off. You've got very few overheads apart from petrol, and you know, you can fit it in around. If you've got another job or a second job, you can fit it in around. So I think it's a really good way of starting off. As everybody said, after a bit, I just got sick of lugging things around, and like Chris said, trying to balance where you work. You know, when people are phoning you up or trying to book, they want certain days, and it's hard to split days and where you are. I'm in quite a rural area, so the distance thing became a bit of an issue, and I was just getting busy enough to then have a place of my own. So it's a really nice sort of progression, a way of building your business, and those clients then came to see me in my first clinic, so that was great. I think there's an element, actually, weirdly, now that my business has developed slightly and I'm doing more rehab work, that it would almost, I'm not going to do it because I don't want to be lugging stuff around again, but sometimes I think it would almost be nice to go back and see people in their own homes to see what tasks they need to be doing, what things they want to do that they can't do, and what rehab you can almost tailor around their home itself a bit, sort of, you know, with a sort of slight occupational health head on, rather than gym based, you can get them doing things in their own home, which I think is a nice thing that you can do as a mobile therapist that we can't necessarily do as well in clinic.
Yeah, that's a really nice observation, actually, that you can actually utilize their environment and tailor it to them much better than if they're in.
Like everyone said, you had some interesting houses. I wasn't as lucky as Claire. I think I might have got the other extreme. Interesting houses, and you quite often get to be people's pets and small children and things like that, sort of small children hanging off you as you're trying to work and things like that, and interesting rooms where you're kind of like clambering over furniture to get around to the other side of people, but like Tamar said, it was fun. there is always that element of you never know what's coming, and it does, like Chris said, I think it takes that pressure off you, although I'm a control freak, I like having my space set up how I want it to be, but on the other hand, when you're going to someone else's house, that is not your responsibility. If the room's cold, that's not your fault, almost, or, you know, if something, so that takes that pressure off you. So yeah, pros and cons.
Right, well, let's see. So it seems like me and Tamar are really the only ones on the mobile side for sure, but I'd love to share with you a few more of my pros and cons for both, actually. I've been doing mobile for about 8 years, and in the last 2 years I started working from home because of COVID. Mobile just seemed like not a good idea, and I think in the beginning we were told that you wouldn't be allowed to go into people's houses at all, and I didn't really want to either. So for the last couple of years, I've been offering some treatments from home, and I've just started to get back into the mobile things again properly. So it's been interesting kind of seeing things on both sides. I think, you know, working from home, you have apps, or working in a clinic space, whichever one, you've got all of your stuff organised. Like you've said, you can set a really beautiful environment. You've got your plants, you've got your diffusers, you've got all your nice towels. You can make it like a really lush setting to come into. So it's great to have that control of things. From the perspective of working from home, the one thing that I do struggle with is kind of separating personal and professional space. And if someone does need to come through your house, either to use the bathroom, or if the treatment room is located within the house, then, you know, people are coming into your personal space. And I do find that a little bit tricky, because you feel under pressure to keep the space immaculate. And, there's kind of boundaries between personal and professional. the other thing is if you have pets, I have a cat who can be quite naughty and demanding. And so I've had to find a way to keep him right out of the way when I'm treating from home, because otherwise he'll scratch at the door and he'll yell and he'll want to be fed and he wants attention, or lie outside the door so when you come out it'll just fall over him. So there's those sort of things as well, which obviously you wouldn't come across if you're treatment room was outside of the house, but those are a couple of things I found to be more challenging with the home setup. But overall, it's quite convenient and I do quite like it. So yes, have to give you a little point, but let me come back with some mobile. Yeah, Tomar's cheering. So then over to the mobile side, I think what Amy said, when you're starting up and you don't want to have all these overheads and you just want to fit in a few treatments here and there a week, it's really flexible to be mobile. The only real overhead that you have regularly is your fuel, which I mean is going up, but you know, in comparison to a room rental, and that can be a lot more affordable. And it does depend what your fees are, but I think that there is actually the opportunity to earn more when you're mobile, earn more and see less. Of course, it varies on what your setup would be, but I do actually think there's opportunity for that. So you've got to sort of weigh up what that would look like for you. The setting is important, I think, whether you're rural or whether you're in a city. And I think that that could make a big difference to how much you enjoy being mobile. I've never had to do it in a city environment, so I can't really comment, but it does seem to be more challenging with access and with getting around. So I guess with that, you'd need to just be very upfront with your information and let people know around what parameters they can book. Like, do they need their own parking space? Do they cover your travel fees? And just have some clear boundaries that they've got to work around for you to go and visit them. I used to have a branded vehicle actually, so it was really good when I was driving around. It's like a you know, really good advertisement, and once you've paid for the ad to actually be wrapped around your car, you know, that is free advertising. And I'd drive all over the place and people would stop me and they'd be, oh, you know, can I book in? And I'd go, yeah, you know, take the details off the car. And that is a really good way to get yourself out there, particularly if you've got all your branding and your colours and things. It's a really good way to get in front of people, so you can make the most of that when you're driving around. The cons definitely being the heavy equipment. So the thing to do right away is invest in good quality, lightweight equipment, because it will, pay dividends to do that. I think you've got to look after yourself first and foremost and your back. So making sure you can lift what you have comfortably is super important. And just making sure that you've scheduled breaks into your day as well. It's easy to travel around and forget to schedule a lunch break in or something. So if you're doing the travel yourself, if you're driving, just making sure that you've made space for you to have a little sit down and a little breather in between clients as well. And the last thing, sorry, I've babbled a little bit, but I'll just say the last thing also to be cautious of with mobile is that you are in a bit more of a vulnerable position, and safety is something that you do need to be considering. I have a very clear terms and conditions that clients see before they book, and they have to agree to it in order to book, which says that we have a zero tolerance policy towards any sort of unruly behavior, so any form of aggression, any form of intoxication, any signs but anybody sort of trying to take advantage. So you do have to be careful of that, and having a few things in place, maybe let people know where you're going, particularly if it's a new client. I think you've got to be sensible and make sure that you're looking after yourself. So yeah, I think those are my main pros and cons for both. And I could go on a bit more, but I won't do that because we've got some more to get through. Did anybody else want to? Yeah.
Do you have a vetting, kind of like a vetting system at all? Just I was thinking about safety because before you said it, so with male clients, I would only see people that had been recommended. You know, they had to have a link. It couldn't just be a random person, particularly with male clients. So they had to be, you know, a partner of somebody, or they had to come through, you know, a certain route. That's how I felt comfortable. And I just wondered if you have any kind of system in place like that.
Yeah, I think that's a really good question. So yes, I do. I have, again, as part of terms and conditions, I have a paragraph that says that you may be called if this is your first time booking as part of our additional vetting and safety protocol. Yeah. So we have that in place so people can see. I think it's very clear also through the rest of our terms that we really just don't tolerate any funny business. And so we don't really get any problems with that anymore. In the early days they did, but I've kind of found ways to make sure it's very clear, you know, just don't bother coming here if that's what you're after. But I do find obviously you have to be cautious, but also I don't like to discriminate against men just because they are men and, you know, and they want a treatment. And you've got, for me personally, I want to be sort of conscious of that, not just to instantly sort of, you know, feel a red flag is going up because it's a male booking a treatment. And to be honest, most of our clients come through word of mouth, come through recommendation anyway. So, you know, most people are linked one way or another, or it's the husband of a client or so and so like that.
Sorry, Kate, I'll have to leave because I've got a mobile now and I've got a train to catch in 9 minutes. All right. So thank you so much for your time.
Cool. Thanks for joining us.
Take care.
See you soon. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
I was just going to say, but obviously Tamer's gone now, so he can't back me up. But being a bloke as well, going into someone else's home, especially if it's a female, for instance, and if she's not got anyone else in the house, like a husband or housemate or whatever it might be, that plays on your mind a little bit as well, because obviously you're in their house, and obviously you're there to do a professional service. But if you know, I'm sure it would never happen, but if they were to ever say something against you, even though it didn't happen, and it wouldn't look good for you as a male therapist going into, you know, in that situation, I would really expect that it would look, you know, everyone would just presume that the allegation was true. I mean, you know, thankfully nothing like that's ever happened with me, but it does play on your mind a little bit sometimes in them situations. You would think, like, you know, oh god, you know, that'd be, I mean, that's enough to just ruin your whole business, isn't it, you know? I don't know why someone would do that. Maybe they wouldn't, but it does, things like that do play on your mind in the opposite sort of respect. But yeah,
that's a scary thought. And is there anything that you can do to kind of minimize the risk of something like that happening?
I think
the insurance companies now do have a policy that you can take out to help at least protect you and get you legal representation. I've seen it's come up when I've renewed my insurance policy.
The only thing with that is it only takes one bad review or something of anything in that nature, and no one will ever book in with you again, regardless to whether you're deemed as, you know, innocent. If it goes to court and blah blah blah. I think for me, so because I personally choose which home visits I do, and it only tends to be like clients that have seen me loads in the past, or a client that might be vulnerable, and in them cases they've always got their carer or support worker sort of thing with them anyway, so that's never really an issue. But I think what I would say is that you'd I don't know, it's weird because you wouldn't want to say, like, please make sure someone else is in the house kind of thing to them, because then they might be thinking, hold on, well, why? Do you know what I mean? And then you're planting that seed in their head then thinking, oh, well, do I actually want you to come? At the end of the day, you're there to do professional service, and I think you've just got to use your own judgment. If the emails or the conversation just seems a little bit not right, you've just got to trust your instincts, haven't you? And I think, and maybe say, sorry, I'm busy, or I don't think I'm the right therapist for you, and maybe pass it on to a female therapist instead, for instance, in them situations, and get them to go. It's not worth the 40 quid or 50 quid, whatever it might be you're getting just for that one session, if something doesn't feel right, because, you know.
Yeah, I would absolutely say that, just to go on from that. Just, I think you know, it's really important to trust your instincts with any of this. Like, if anything feels slightly off key, just, you know, actually, I'm busy, I'm really sorry, you know, and refer them on, or, you know. But yeah, I think it's, yeah, I think you need to put things in place that are your, I don't know, boundaries, but also to, you know, vet people. If it's, you know, an online booking that you get, maybe it is that you call them up and you have a quick chat, like, oh, where did you hear about me? You know, at least then you have a bit of a sense of who they are because you've spoken to them, and where they found you. I think that's quite a good way to kind of get around it, maybe.
There's an app you can get, obviously, from a Safety For You thing called Colleaguard. I think we was based,
Oh,
actually, I
yeah,
think
I've
it's
heard of
quite
that,
local to
actually.
us, Kate, after a
I've
hairdresser
heard of it.
had an incident. And so you can put an app, and it's got different things within the app. So it's got alarms and things like that. But you can also let somebody know if you're not back by a certain time, and it's got a tracking thing if you want to use that. So there's quite a few safety options on it, and it's free. It's called HollyGuard, I think.
Yeah, do you know, I was trying to remember the name of that app when I was writing down my notes earlier. So yeah, thank you for bringing that up, because I just couldn't remember what it was called. But I think also if you're worried about perhaps people getting the wrong idea with parts of the treatment or something that could be interpreted wrong, particularly if you, as you said, a male therapist going into a female household, you might just want to consider what types of treatment you would offer as mobile. Like, there are some styles of massage which could be interpreted as being more sort of sensual than others. So perhaps that's something that you could consider if your male therapist going into a mobile setting, and you're just kind of a bit more deliberate about what therapies that you offer, just in case, you know, something was to be interpreted the wrong way. Like, perhaps, for instance, I don't want to sort of make this a problem for anyone, but perhaps something like Lomi Lomi massage, where they're not wearing underwear, and the, you know, strokes are very fluid and flowy. Something like that could be interpreted, you know, in the wrong way. So maybe that would be something just to consider.
I remember one of my first ever mobile treatments that I did when I'd just qualified, and it was some guy got in touch through my website and was like, you know, I've seen your website, blah blah blah. Can you, you know, I'd love to book in. And obviously, it was all new to me, this. So it was like, thinking back now, maybe the he just things, I don't know. Anyway, I went and the and while I'm in there, the guy just strips off fully naked. And I actually thought, you know, it was weird because half of me thought, is this normal or is this completely inappropriate? But I was so new to it, I just didn't know. But it was such an awkward session, you know, because obviously I covered him fully up in towels and stuff, and like, I didn't. I just made it obvious that, you know, you don't do, you know, well, with me anyway. Yeah, you know, you don't do that. Especially because I was in his home as well, and he was. I don't know. It put me on edge a little bit for the treatment, because obviously there was times where, like, I heard a little noise, for instance, and it was probably just like a creak or something. And then you start thinking, like, I was thinking, is there someone else in the house? And then I was thinking, hold on a sec. He never said there was someone else in the house. Do you know what I mean? And then, so I was like doing the treatment, and I was constantly like just kind of looking over my shoulder a little bit, you know, thinking, I don't know what I was thinking, to be honest, but I'd like kind of planned the exit routes like subconsciously.
Oh, Chris, that sounds terrible.
I know. And I'd also, as daft as it sounds, I was like, right, well, there's a heavy ornament there, so if anything goes wrong, I thought, right, well, I've got self. Honestly, it was like, all these thoughts were going through my head. All because this guy just stripped off naked and was just stood there, and I was just kind of thinking, in reality now, I'd have just said, you know, fast forward a year or even 6 months or whatever, I'd have just turned around and said, can you put some clothes on, please? You know, I'd have had a laugh with him and just been like, can you put your pants back on, mate? You know, and he'd have probably gone, oh, right, yeah, no, sorry, no, yeah, you know. But he never booked in again. And, you know, he obviously maybe got the
He
right
probably ass. Picked up on how uncomfortable you were.
Yeah. I think so, yeah, it was just I remember ringing my missus after it, you know, and just being, because it was my first home visit, you know what I mean? And she had texted me, how did it all go and that? And I was like, well.
That's not a good start to the mobile world, is that? I know. That's scarring.
I know, but
But you learn from these things as well, don't you?
Yeah.
Next time you know that you, before they start taking off clothes, you can say, you know, if you can go down to your underwear and get on the table. So you learn that dialogue, don't you, of how
I
to
think
sort of help
that's
people.
Just, it's just made me remember, and it sounds probably really obvious, but as soon as I'd get in there, I think they would be chatting to me, but I'd say, right, where's your bathroom? And just make sure that they knew that I was going to go to the bathroom to wash my hands. You know, that was my dialogue. Where is your bathroom? Because before you get undressed, I'm going to go into the bathroom, wash my hands, and then you can give me a shout when you're on the couch, and, you know, be really explicit about that, about that you were going to remove yourself from their space for them to kind of then get on the couch. I very much remember I was quite clinical about that in my approach, and that always worked for me anyway. Might sound quite obvious, but yeah.
But it's going back to the things that we should be doing anyway in clinic. It's sort of good consultation. It is explaining what you're going to do very clearly and asking them if that's okay. So I'm going to be working here doing this. Is that okay with you? So they know, so they're not going to accuse you of anything. And then, you know, they need to agree. So that's consent, isn't it? And then it's that, and this is, you know, we're going to put the towel here. I'm going to leave the room. I'll get you, let you get undressed to this or that, whatever they're taking off. Please lie here under the sheet, facing up, facing down, whatever it is. It's that communication, informed consent. I mean, which really, even, you know, in clinic we should be doing, but I guess maybe it's even more important in that environment.
I think that sets the rules out then, and the boundaries, and straight away.
Yeah, exactly. It's the rules.
If anyone is thinking, you know, the wrong thing or got the wrong end of the stick, straight away you've just laid out bang bang bang.
Absolutely,
this is what happens.
Yeah.
This is how the session's going to run. This is what I'll be doing. These are the areas I'll be, you know, and then they'll probably be thinking, right, well, this, you know.
I think I was almost a bit I was almost a bit strict in a way, you know, just kind of in there, this is what, you know, and it just always works. I think that's a good way to kind of set your boundaries, set the plans, and set the mood.
Yeah,
and it's good, particularly if you haven't done many treatments before, like if you are a new therapist and you are new to mobile, is to kind of practice how all of that works. You know, when you get in, what do you say? You know, for me, I enter and I, you know, say, hey, how are you doing and stuff? Where would you like me to set up? I let them know that if they want to go and put on their dressing gown or get some water or wash their hands, I'm just going to be a minute to get the couch set up. And once that's set up, they come back and I chat to them about their treatment, do their consultation. And then I hold up the drape, I ask them to get onto the couch after they've gone down to their underwear. So you kind of, you learn that pattern of what you need to say. But it takes some getting used to. And if you haven't done it before, it's definitely worth practicing this scenario in your head by yourself. Because you might
or
get into the moment
at home
and just kind of forget what you're saying, or
totally,
you know,
I remember when we did the training, I was one last point, but I remember when I was doing my training, it was all things like that, that they didn't actually teach you about, you know, they taught you how to do, everything was crammed into such a short space of time, you know, obviously wherever you're doing your training, they're limited to what hours they've got in the venue that they've hired, for instance. So it is all about the massage, which I understand is, and they touch a little bit on like business stuff and that. I remember they made you have to put a little business plan together or something like that. But things like draping the towels, holding the towels whilst the client gets on, they never really touched on that properly. It was kind of like you were just left to have to do all that yourself, which I understand, you know, you do learn as you go along, don't you? And you get better at these things as time goes by and stuff. But they should really, all these, this, the etiquette should be taught as just as important as actually doing the routine, the massage routine. Because
yeah, I really agree with that.
If you get one wrong thing and someone leaves you a bad review because of, you know, a simple mistake that you were never actually taught, you know, then it could all just be gone anyway.
Yeah,
it's a good course for somebody to do. Actually, it's a really good mini course for somebody to set up. Things that you might, you know, exactly this sort of thing is what therapists don't get taught that they should get taught.
There's a new one for you, Kate.
There you go, Kate.
For me.
Massage warehouse, sorry. Massage warehouse etiquette. Massage etiquette.
Yeah, that would be a really good one. Yeah.
I've had mothers screaming at the kid through the massage hole. You know, that's the kids playing FIFA in the room next door, for instance, and it's been too loud.
Only the best trained therapists know how to massage the like and subscribe buttons. Thanks for supporting the show.
Just for fun. Does anyone have any memorable mobile moments that they want to share? I know I've got a couple, but does anybody else want to share before that?
I think for me, one of them would have been that, but it wasn't really a memorable in a funny way. It was quite scarring for life, actually. But as with everyone, there's been, you know, I've had mothers screaming at the kid through the massage hole, you know, that's the kids playing FIFA in the room next door, for instance, and it's been too loud and the mum's going,
just laughing at Claire wetting herself there with that one.
And it's a dead relaxing treatment, and then just out of nowhere the mum screams, will you effing shut up in that room, I'm trying to chill out, you know, that sort of thing. I've turned up to people's houses before, like friends of friends, when I've agreed to do a home visit. And it's like on an evening and it's like the Champions League final or something like that's going on. And the guy's like, do you mind if I just leave this on? And I'm like, well, it changed the whole vibe of the treatment completely. However, I did quite enjoy it in a strange sense, listening to the football commentary while doing the treatment. He was quite a sporty lad anyway. So it ended up becoming more of a sports sort of style session rather than a relaxing in the zone kind of thing. So I was a bit at first. Adapted well, yeah. But there are loads of things like that. I've had clients that are well into the music that have like want heavy metal on and stuff like that. And again, that's something you're in their environment. So it's just like, yeah, whatever, you know, whatever's cool, man. And I just go with it, you know, it's their session. But postmen come into the door and they've had to jump up with a towel because it's something they've been waiting for so long. And they need, you know, all these things I've had over the time. But yeah, that's me.
That just made me think of one, actually. So I've got a few here. The one you just made me think of had a debt collector come to the door for one of my clients once. Luckily, I knew her very well, and we had a laugh about it. It was for her son and not for her. But that was interesting. For the same client, actually, so we've had quite a past together. When I first started out, I forgot my couch and I turned up for her treatment and just went, oh, I've forgotten my couch. So I had to drive 20 minutes back down the road, get my couch and come back again. So it helps to have a packing list and don't forget your couch. Also, I've had people not being home and you're just there and you're knocking on the door and they're not home. I've had really bad access, but you know, like spiral metal staircase or something. animals lying around. I had a very needy dog once that would not lie anywhere else but right under the face cradle of that owner, and they wouldn't move, and the owner didn't want them to move either. And I just thought, I, you know, just can't work really like this. What else do we have? I've ended up in a hoarder's house, which was really, really icky. I did not enjoy being there. I just felt like a bit like you, Chris. I was kind of looking around like, oh, what's around the corner? Yeah, you can end up in some funny old situations. Those are the ones that I could remember. So we're going to wrap up now, and just we'll finish with a few bits of advice for new therapists or people thinking of going into mobile massage. If you've got any advice.
I was just going to say, just going on the fact that when you forgot your couch, just if you have, you know, if you're going to do lots of it and you've also got a practice at home or ever, you know, get the spare stuff, get the extra kit that stays in your car, which I'm sure you obviously do, Kate, but just have your kit that is there so you're not forgetting stuff, so you haven't forgotten your clock or your really important bits and pieces that make the treatment. I think that's a good investment for your sanity, probably.
Yeah, absolutely. For a while, I'd juggle sort of taking stuff in and out of the treatment room and back to mobile, and you end up forgetting stuff because you're only human. That also helps have a packing list, particularly if you are new. So, you know, you make sure you've got all your towels and your covers and your drapes and your oils and your music, any other bits that you need. So a packing list is definitely quite helpful. I'd definitely research sort of pricing in your area and set good prices, because it's always hard to change your prices or to put them up. You absolutely can do and you should do, but I know I've struggled with that a lot throughout my career. So make sure that you start out with good pricing. Just being organized as well, really know your day, really map your route. I always use Google Maps to check how far something is for me to travel to, and I just make sure that the day makes sense and that if you've got to make any adjustments that you can do that. You've got all your stuff, you've got your water, you've got your food, or you know where you're going to stop for food. So being organized, I think, is really important. Said about the packing list. And just reiterating what I said earlier, investing in quality light equipment is really good. Have a good kit bag that isn't going to fall apart, that you've got all your stuff in. I use a holdall which has wheels on it, so I can wheel it along or I can carry it, so you've kind of got that option. And just to be safe and to have clear policies that protect you and to set the client's expectations about how a session works and whether it's suitable or not for their environment. So those are my top tips. Chris or Imogen, would you like to add anything to that?
I was just going to say, like, I hope it's not put any, you know, obviously some of my experiences and stuff, I hope it's not put anyone off, because I do think that when you're starting out, I think mobile is the way to start personally, because you need to check that you like what you're doing. You need to perfect your routine, your style of massage, and you don't want to get tied into paying loads of money renting somewhere while you're still building up a client base. And you know, I'm sure, like you say, if you do the rounds doing the mobile thing, people will then, when you do set up and get your own premises, people are more likely to then, you've already kind of got, you know, a decent following that will then hopefully come to your place. You just got to be, you know, trust your instincts. That's the only thing I'd say is that if something don't feel right and you don't feel, you get an uneasy feeling about it, don't feel you have to do the session, because it's you know, more, there will be more. Just pass it on. And I think it's good. I know I was pro treatment room rather than and mobile, but I do think you need to do the mobile thing really to get started, at least if you're brand new and you're just starting out. So yeah.
Yeah, I think that one thing I thought of as well is that you can always ask, it's nice if you can do two people in that household. So, you know, even if someone's booking, it's worth calling them and asking the question, is there anyone else in the house that wants a massage at the same time? And then you doubled your money, you know, it's a good one to definitely ask.
Yeah, absolutely. And from my mobile business, you know, we get a lot of that. We get a lot of couples, we get a lot of group bookings. So we can be somewhere for a day, and we're charging mobile rates for that. So you can make a fantastic day's wage if you do stuff like that. Again, you know, it is swings and roundabouts. There are pros and cons to both. But, you know, I've made my business. I make my income through mobile, and I love it. And I get to visit, you know, some amazing places, get to visit some really lovely people, some really lovely clients. And, you know, we've just talked about the funny stories because, you know, they're funny and they're memorable. But for the most part, you know, it's really enjoyable. And how about you, Imogen? Is there anything you want to add before we close the session today?
No, not really. Just what you said is, I think the time that you spend organising before you go, whether, like you said, it's your equipment or actually policies and boundaries and writing it down so that you and your clients know where you're at before you turn up. They know what they're getting and what they're not getting. They know what to expect. You can even, I know some people, if carrying a lot of things is an issue, they can ask their clients to provide some of the towels and drapes that saves you doing it.
Yeah.
So it's really that planning, thinking things through, almost sort of, you know, you said to sort of plan in your head, but you could almost go around your mum's and as if you were going to do it and thinking, oh my God, yeah, I hadn't thought of that. That's really awkward. How do I get around that? So having a sort of walkthrough and just getting everything as much as possible in your control so that the little things that might be out of your control when you get there are just that, just little things.
Yeah, having a dry run or like a demo, I think is a really good idea. I've just noticed as well that if look over my shoulder, my chair's blocking the way, but there is a pile of my mobile stuff ready to go there. I've got a bolster on top of my bag. I've got my other bag next to the other bag, which is full of new drapes because I've got two people on the road today. So I have to change over the kit. So that is organised, ready to go. Organisation right there. Lovely. Well, guys, look, it's been great chatting to you. This is the last one in the series for now, I think, and we're going to be sort of shaking things up a bit and having a little think about how to do things going forward. So it's been great chatting with you all for the last year, and really got to know you all a lot better, and it's been great. You're all fantastic people, and looking forward to hopefully continuing our conversations going forward. So for listeners,
thank you for hosting, Kate.
Hosting
every week. You are fantastic too.
Oh, well, thank you. I know I do a terrible job sometimes and fall over my
words. No, never.
You get what I'm saying, but you know, only human. if you would like to be alerted to when the next episode goes live, just hit the subscribe button or sign up to the newsletter in the description below. So guys, I'll speak to you again. Have a great day and see you soon. Bye. Bye.